This morning's talk centers around the tribute to Naqshbandi Sufi Omkarnath Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu or he is also known as popularly as Bhaiyaji, a tribute to Naqshbandi Sheikh Sufi Omkarnath. Hazaron saal Nargis apni benuri pe roti hai, badi mushkil se hota hai chaman mein didawar paida hui. Thousands of years humanity laments over its saga of misery, misfortune and calamity. Then somewhere, someone is born who has the inner capabilities, vision and awareness to transform all those who come in contact with him. Solemn are the moments of life spent in thy company. Solemn are the moments of life spent in thy company. Verily have these become the moments of life divine. Verily have these become the moments of life divine. As the moments of Nisbat Naqshbandi. Nisbat means inner connection. Normally you can connect to the people through the physical being. You shake your hand, you have a hello, you have a bye. This is here, you are connecting to the sense organs, the five sense organs, the eyes, the ears, the nose, the throat, the touch. When the connection is because of these, it is known as a physical connection. You see someone, the person is beautiful, appeals to you, or speaks something good. All this, when it happens, it is because of the physical connection. Beyond this, there is a magnetic connection. As you enter somewhere, you feel the magnetic presence of someone that you cannot resist. Either looking at him or paying an attention. This is another level. If you are still at a deeper level, you will feel something magnanimous about a person. There is a power within that knows beyond our knowings. We are not aliens nor as strangers joined. We are bound to each other by a causeless force. When we understand the realm of this, a different kind of connection is established. And also along the spiritual journey, when the connection goes beyond the physical, mental and intellectual levels, it is known as Nisbat. It is known as inner connection. It is known as soul's connection. It is not that this connection is not there. Simply because we have created the barriers that the connection becomes non-functional. We have created many barriers around us because of our ego, because of our ignorance, because of our fear, because of many other reasons, because the conditionings of the society and the religions. Look at your house. Your house has many rooms. Each room is separated, has its own ambience, its own aura, and is separated from the other room because of the walls, because of the ceiling, because of the roof, because of the doors, because of the windows. So a person who is sitting in room A will not be able to hear what is going on in room B or room C. It is only when all the people come in one common space, maybe the dining room, maybe the sitting room area, which is a common place where everyone can come in, but there is a decorum. Everyone has to appear in a particular way. Whereas in your bedroom, in the privacy of your rooms, you can remain in whatever position you want to be. There is a decorum of the place. So too we have created, and then, as I said, the person sitting in room A will not know anything that is going on in room B. This is how man has created many barriers around him. Sometimes these are visible and sometimes they are invisible. The barrier that I am rich, the other is poor, I am Indian, the other is of some other nationality, I am tall, short, black, white. All these are the invisible barriers that we create around us, and because of that, the interconnectivity is lost. The very purpose of spiritual growth is to break these barriers and come out in the open space where you have the entire sky as the canopy. The breeze, the chirping of the birds, the sunlight, the moonlight, everything is there for you. When you come to this space where all are connected, you are connected to the masters of the past because of your inner connections. The masters who are physically alive and those who have gone beyond, no more available physically. They are in the realm of the beyond. When you have established, you have a powerful radio frequency that you can connect to the various television channels, various radio channels, and listen to the broadcast. It is known as inner connection. It is known as nispara. Through this mechanism of sky, people in far and far away countries, places, can come together. People from different countries can come together, listen to the broadcast, and also see the visual aspect of it. This is what happens when one attains to the nispara. Verily have these become the moments of light divine, as the moments of nisbat-e-naqshbandi too. Now adorn my life, my living, my being. Flowers get verily jealous as these moments fill each congregation with humble prayer, each finite moment. This is the English translation. Now I will use the Hindi and Urdu mixed composition. Guzre hai lamhe zindagi ke teri sohbat. Guzre hai lamhe zindagi ke teri sohbat mein jo. Solemn are the moments of life spent in thy company. Ban gaye hai wo aaj lamhe noor zindagi ke meri. Ban gaye hai wo aaj lamhe noor zindagi ke meri. Lamhe noor means the moments. Lamha means a very precise moment. And noor means light. Zindagi means life. बन गए हैं वो आज लम्हे नूर जिंदगी के मेरी, वेरीली हैव दीज बिकम द मोमेंट्स ऑफ लाइफ डिवाइन. फर्स्ट दे बिकम द मोमेंट्स ऑफ लाइफ डिवाइन एंड देन एज द मोमेंट्स ऑफ नक्शबंदी नक्शबंदी दे अडोर्न माय लाइफ. बन के निस्बते नक्शबंदी, बन के निस्बते नक्शबंदी, छाए है जिंदगी में मेरी. बन के निस्बते नक्शबंदी, छाए है जिंदगी में मेरी. फूलों को है रंजिश महकाते हैं आशियाने को जब, फूलों को है रंजिश महकाते आशियाने को जब. फ्लावर्स आर एंडोर्ड विद द क्वालिटी ऑफ स्प्रेडिंग इट्स ब्यूटी एंड फ्रेग्रेंस वेर एवर दे गो, वेर एवर दे आर. दिस इज वाई वी ऑफर द बुके ऑफ फ्लावर्स फॉर वेरियस ऑकेजंस ऑफ सैंक्टिटी. An ashyana means a congregation of lovers and beloveds. The flowers get jealous when these moments, wherever they are, the moments of inner flowering, wherever they are, they spread beauty and fragrance. Phoolon ko hai ranjish mehkate hai aashiyane ko jab, महकाते हैं आशियाने को जब. गुजर रही है जिंदगी उन्हीं लम्हों के सदके में अब. नाउ माई लाइफ इज स्प्रेडिंग, लाइफ इज मूविंग ऑन इन द प्रोफाइल्स, इन द शैडो, इन द लाइट ऑफ दोज मोमेंट्स. Those moments of life and awareness. Guzar rahi hai zindagi, my life is moving on and in the shadow of those moments. Unhi lamho ke sadke. Guzar rahi hai zindagi, unhi lamho ke sadke mein ab. गुजर रही है जिंदगी उन्हीं लम्हों के सदके में अब. गुजरती जाए जिंदगी ही दुआ है बस यही रब से. मे माई लाइफ बी स्पेंट लाइक दिस एवलॉन्ग, सच इज माई अम्बल प्रेयर ईच फाइनाइट मोमेंट. Such is my humble prayer each final moment. Guzre hai lamhe zindagi ke, guzre hai lamhe zindagi ke, teri sohbat mein jo, teri sohbat mein jo, ban gaye hai wo aaj lamhe noor zindagi. जिंदगी के मेरी बन के निस्बते नक्शबंदी, छाए है जिंदगी में मेरी. बन के निस्बते नक्शबंदी, छाए है जिंदगी में मेरी. फूलों को है रंजिश, फूलों को है रंजिश, महकाते हैं आशियाने को जब. महकाते हैं आशियाने को जब. गुजर रही है जिंदगी उन्हीं लम्हों के सदके में अब. गुजर रही है जिंदगी उन्हीं लम्हों के सदके में अब. गुजरती जाए जिंदगी ही दुआ है बस यही रब से, दुआ है यही बस रब से। Now this particular composition is in the voice of Sufi Omkar Nath Razi Allah Ta'ala Uno. This particular couplet says that the two friends, the beloved, the lover is telling her friend, come friend, let us play the game of dice with our beloved. The female one is saying to her friends, because in the company of the master, company of the beloved, everyone is of feminine nature because of the devotion. This is why it says all the people who have love for Krishna, they are feminine in nature, because love is the quality of the feminine one. So the two friends say to one another, friends, come, let us play the game of dice with our beloved. If I win, I will attain the company of the master. I will attain the company of my beloved. And if I lose, I will lose in the hands of my beloved. That also is meaningless. So both ways, it is my victory. Whether I lose, then I will lose in the hands of my beloved. And if I win, I will win the company of my beloved. This is a particular couplet which is in his voice. Listen to the voice of Naqshbandi, Sufi Omkar Nath Razi Allah Ta'ala. This particular couplet, as I mentioned, the two female friends are talking among themselves, friends, come and let us play the game of dice. Chausar is the game of dice, an ancient game. Game of dice with our beloved. If I win, I will win over my beloved, and if I lose, I will lose in the hands of my beloved. So both ways it is my victory. Whether I win or lose, I am victorious in both ways. And that is the beauty of this composition. A master comes like a book from the divine library, makes himself available for a certain period of time, and then disappears like a dewdrop, disappearing, slipping from the leaf into the lane. Lucky are those who get an opportunity to read a few pages here and there of that book. This is a living book. Each master is a living book. we must have the company, we must have the capability to listen to those. Listen to those, read the pages of that book before it disappears into the oblivion and goes back to the divine land. In the month of October 1934, to the divine parentage of Naqshbandi Brijmohanlal Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu and Sufi Shakuntala Devi was born a male child. After two children, a male boy and a girl. Of this, the first child has passed away in his youth. Then the daughter, and after that a child was born and was given the name of Omkar. Omkar is the existential sound, the uncreated, the unheard sound that is the very cause of the cosmos. And in deep silence you hear that silence. In deep silence you hear that echo within and without. Omkarnath is that existential sound. Only in the silence of your being you can hear the whispers, like the whispers of the unknown. Unlike various other masters, unlike many other masters whose birth is not clear, because all these masters appear mysteriously and disappear too in the mysterious ways and means. Out of their own free will, they visit the planet and then when the work is over, they disappear. He was born during a period which is known as, according to Hindus, as inauspicious period. It is the period when the Hindus pay respect to their departed ancestors. And it is not considered as an auspicious period, and during that time, Hindus do not perform any auspicious works like marriage and things like that, which requires the auspiciousness. This is a period of 15 days. Thereafter, the festival of Dashera comes in, during which the acts of Shri Ram is portrayed all around, known as Ram Leela, the portrayal, the acts of Shri Ram, his victory over the demon king Ravan, and this is followed by Diwali, the festival of lights. So it is after the inauspicious period of when Hindus paid respect to their departed ancestors, comes the Dashera period, the period of 10 days where the victorious deeds of Shri Ram are displayed all around. It is during that period that Hindus also celebrate. It's a period of 9 days known as nine nights, where the female form of The energy is worshipped as Lakshmi, Durga, and Saraswati. And it is during that period that the spiritual gathering takes place at the shrine of Sufi Naqshbandi Braj Mohanlal Wazir Allah Ta'ala. So it was suggested by the grandmother of Sufi Omkar Nath that let his birthday be celebrated on the 5th day of the lunar calendar, not in the month where he was born, but in, during the period when it is auspicious, that is the period of 9 days of the female worship of the female energy. His birthday was being celebrated during that day, and which actually falls according to the lunar dates on the 2nd day of the function. It's a great congregation. Many people have gathered. So everybody gets an opportunity to witness this birthday celebration of their beloved friend and master. And thereafter this incident, this event got further new dimensions were added to it when the fourth son of Sufi Omkar Nath and Shyamvati Devi was born on the same 2nd day of the spiritual gathering, as and he is known as Prakash Mohan. So the celebration doubled, and then thereafter the son of the younger brother of Sufi Omkar Nath, Sufi Devendranath's son Rakesh, was born on the same day. Omkar Nath continued to live under the guidance of his parents and the grandfather in an environment which was spiritually surcharged. You have to develop the mindfulness when you are in the company of the masters like this. A mere slip into awareness, you are given a work to be done and you miss it. It is the way the master works. It happened after Sufi Braj Mohanlal's eldest daughter got married in 1949. It happened that his son-in-law's younger brother came to the city of Lucknow to further his higher educations. So it so happened that this person, that Sufi Braj Mohanlal's son-in-law's younger brother, his name was Puttan. Puttan Babu. Babu means, as a matter of respect, we use the word Babu means respectable gentleman after the name of the person. So Puttan and Omkar Nath were of the same age, so they developed a friendship among themselves. They study together, they go to the university together, studying the BSc, they pursuing the bachelor's degree in science, and continue to live in an environment of spiritually charged under the benign care of his parents. It happened one day somebody has invited Sufi Braj Mohanlal, a Swami has invited him to visit to a particular place. So he asked his son Omkar Nath to set the alarm of the clock because he has to get up in the morning early and get ready to go to the railway station to catch the train. And it so happened that Omkarnath asked Puttan Babu to set the alarm. So the alarm was set, and thereafter, in the next morning, when the master was to get up, the alarm went berserk. It did not click at the time when it was supposed to be. It happened he was supposed to wake up at 4 o'clock and then get ready to catch the train. The alarm, because of the device of the master, was set for 5 o'clock, 1 hour delayed. So he went to the railway station thinking that it is the time. There he came to know that the train has already departed and the clock was wrong. He came back. Now Omkarnath saw that my father has returned. He got a little worried, but somehow he did not apprehend any problem arising. So he came in front of the master. The master said, "This is the way you set the clock. What the person where I was to go would be thinking about me. And you were asked to set the alarm at a particular time and you did not set it rightly. Now, in order to remove his name, he said, "Sir, that alarm was not set by me but by Puttan." When this other person heard that his name is being called and he is the responsible one who did not set the alarm right, so what to do? He remained upstairs. He said he will not come down. So the house was in such a way that these boys have gotten the opportunity to occupy the upstairs place where they used to study and everything, because downstairs all the time the visitors were there and the meditation, the talks, all the sessions used to continue, and these boys had problem in focusing on their studies, so they stayed upstairs. When Puttan heard, so he said that there he thought to himself, using his wisdom, that if I do not go in front of the master, everybody used to call him Pitaji, that's affectionately, and Pitaji is the word refers to father, just as we say father or dad or something like that. He said, "I will not come down for the rest of the day, so by evening Pitaji will forget about this incident." It so happened in the around the dusk, Sufi Brijmohan Lal has the habit of going to the washroom, and the area was such that the steps, there was the entrance from outside, then the toilet area, and thereafter the steps to go up. He was coming down through these steps, and Sufi Brijmohan Lal was going to the bathroom area. There was, and the two eyes met. There was no opportunity or chance for Puttan to run back upstairs. He has to stay there. If he had heard his footsteps before, he would have probably made his way upstairs. But it was in such a way that he was halfway and the master appeared in front of him. And the first thing after the whole days, Sufi Brijmohan Lal asked, "Yes, Mr. Puttan Babu, it was you who set the clock?" And he did not have any words to say anything. Now you imagine what would have happened at that time. And probably Putan was not even aware of that situation, what had happened to him. This is the device of the master, how he creates the situation. Creates the situation of emptying your mind, taking you to the state of no mind when there is no thought. At that moment there can be no thought in the minds of Putan Baba. Because he is completely overwhelmed by the energy of the master. The ignorant one consider this as nagging, but these are the Sufi devices. Gurdjieff was subjected to such devices. When Leon Leopold went in search of the masters, and the first master that he met, he said, "What did you teach Gurdjieff?" The master said, "I taught him how to breathe." Immediately, the one Leon said, "Breathing?" The master said in a very loud voice, "Do you think you know how to breathe? There is a correct way of breathing. When every breath that comes in and every breath that goes out, you are aware of it. You move with the breath when it comes in and you move out when the breath goes out. This is Vipassana meditation. You're looking at your breath. You are watching your breath, and the moment you start watching your breath, the stampede of thoughts becomes less and less, and that the moment comes when the thoughts vanish completely, your mind is totally empty. And master creates that situation when he can transfer his energy to the disciple. As such, when an individual comes in the company of the master, he is full of questions, always questions. He does not give any chance to the master to work into the disciple. The disciple thinks that by asking questions, I will be gaining knowledge. Master is not interested in giving you knowledge, he is interested in giving you awareness. The quality of discerning, the quality that can transform you. Knowledge will not transform you because knowledge is memory based. Awareness is not memory based. It is energy based. So that particular moment, the situation that was created, that he is going to the, in both are in perpendicular direction to one another. One is coming from upstairs, and then the other that becomes the base, going, Sufi Brijmohan Lal was in the direction of base, and if you look at the geometrical drawing, one is coming from upstairs, and one, the other is going from the east to west, and the other is coming from upstairs. From upstairs to downstairs. It becomes a perpendicular. Perpendicular, and in that, you are always in the center. When you draw a perpendicular on a straight line, it is always in the center. It becomes the attention-wise the center. And the words that flowed out of Sufi Brijmohan Lal, "Yes, Mr. Putan Babu, you were the one who set the clock." Now he has no words. He starts mingling his words. "Yes, sir, ji, sir. There is total emptiness. The mind is completely empty of thoughts." When the master sees that the disciple has reached the state of total emptiness, sometimes it happens this state comes in the disciple because of certain circumstances and situations that happen naturally. Other times the master creates a situation that you are stuck, dumb for words. Words cannot flow. Sometimes you would have experienced a situation, you have a situation of deja-vu comes. All of a sudden you see such beauty that you have never imagined in your life. You are stuck dumb for words. That moment is the moment of thoughtlessness. That moment is the moment of no mind. That moment is the moment that you can be communicated. The energy can be transferred to you. And this is what happened at that moment. And if you ask really with Puttan Babu, who is still alive, he will not be able to explain the experience of that moment. I was not there at that moment. But I saw through the divine vision that has been bestowed on me what has happened in that. And whenever I narrate this incident, the picture is in front of my eyes. This is the way the masters are remembered. On the days of their birth anniversary, on the days of their death anniversary, on 20th of May 2008, Sufi Omkar Nath entered Samadhi and left his physical world, a book that has come from the divine library and was available to us for a certain period of time, went back in the divine library. This is a moment of tremendous benediction. The appearance of a master is the benediction and his disappearance too, because his life has been a sacrifice. Life has been a life of awareness. Life has been a life of growth, of tremendous beauty and benediction. The another incident which is very important is the incident when he was initiated. In February of 1949, Sufi Brij Mohan Lal's eldest daughter, who happened to be my mother, was married. And thereafter came the occasion of Hindu festival of colors. February, they got married, and March is the month when the Hindus celebrate the holy festival of colors, which is known as Holi. The crop is ready, winter is coming to an end, spring is in the season, there is gaiety, the winter crop is ready to be harvested. It is an occasion of great gaiety and joy. So Sufi Brij Mohan Lal called for his son-in-law to come and celebrate the first festival of colors together. The festival is celebrated that a night before, when the festival actually begins, a holy fire is lit, which is symbolic of another incident of the victory of righteousness over unrighteousness, truth over falsehood. It is known as the story of Prahlad, the young boy who was born to the parentage of the demons, the father would not allow him to worship the Lord that the little boy was aligned to. And he tortured him in every possible way, saying that the father said that I am invincible and most powerful and no one is greater than I. So he tied him up to a pole and said, "Where is your God? Your God is nowhere." The boy said, "My God is everywhere, even in this pole that you have tied me." No place is devoid of him. So it is, then he instructed his sister who was 5 to take the boy and sit down with him in the lap so that he will be consumed with the fire. The sister, which is known as fire or holika, is endowed with the quality that anything that is put into it will burn, but that will not burn. So when his father instructed his sister to take the boy and sit in the fire, thinking that the boy will perish, but instead his sister perished. That is, this is the victory of right over wrong, righteousness over unrighteousness. So holy fire is lit. So it always happens that people go and collect the contributions from the people around the area to have the fire lit, because it requires tremendous amount of wood and everything. So that particular night was that, the night when the three were initiated. So that night around 10 o'clock, the fire is lit early in the morning, some according to the auspicious dates at auspicious time. So it happened that Sufi Brijmohan Lal said that today I will initiate the three, Omkar, Gayatri, the daughter, and the son-in-law, Lallan Babu. He is popularly known as Lallan Babu, otherwise his name is Lakshmi Sahai. So the persons who have loved the master, and then the disciples who loved the master and the children dearly, they were more excited than anything else and ecstatic too. They went to give the message to all these people, but none of them seems to have any interest. When he went to Omkarnath to give him the message that your father has decided to initiate you this evening, tonight, it was a full moon night. So it happened. But Omkarnath, there was a person in the area who was known to be real miser person. He did not want to contribute anything to the occasion. And what he did, he hide everything inside the room so that nobody could get anything, and he locked up himself into the room and went to sleep. But somehow or the other, he had goat which used to be tied on a wooden peg. You know, dig a hole and put this peg, the wooden peg. It's a wooden piece of wooden piece that is used as a peg, and it is stuck in the ground, and the rope of the goat is tied on that so that it has a certain amount of freedom. He was digging out that. So when the message was given to him that the master wants to initiate you, he said, forget about that, I have to dig out this peg first and offer it to the sacrificial fire. Sufi, the Lakshmi Sahai has gotten married only a month ago. He knew nothing about the Sufi ways and means. He knew nothing about the initiation. But she was on the borderline. Gayatri was not interested in, because she was the eyeball of her father. Many times it happens in the past, she has requested the father to get to initiate her. But the father, every time when she made a request, he deferred. He said, not now. So she, out of her own love and affection, got angry that I will not ask from now onwards anything about initiation or ask him to initiate me. Things went on. The three of them were like that. And she said, I am sleepy, I am going to sleep, don't wake me up, don't bother. But then it was the occasion that the master has chosen the hour, chosen the time to initiate the three. The way of initiation is the master helps on to the hand, the disciple puts his hand on the hand of the master, and in the name of the tariqat, the nisbat, the system, or a particular master of the yoga, the current master initiates the disciple, and that begins the inward journey. So first of all, Omkarnath was initiated, then Lakshmi Sahai, the son-in-law, and thereafter, the last, his daughter was, Gayatri was initiated. Usually, in case of, because this system came from the Muslim tradition, so that etiquette is still followed. So in case of the male person, the directly the hand is put on the hands of the master. But in case of the female beings, because of the system, the directly the hand is not put in the hands of the master. Instead, a piece of cloth, a new piece of cloth, one end master holds it in his hand and the other hand the female disciple holds in her hand. And thus, the process of initiation begins. It requires the master carries you in a particular state of no mind through his energy field and then transforms the energy field so that your journey can begin. It is not that without initiation the journey cannot begin. It is not that without initiation the inward journey cannot begin. But it is considered as a customary to initiate. This is the first initiation, the beginning. It is like you have become the part of the mystery school. You have entered the mystery school, you have been registered as the student at the mystery school. When you enter the school, there is a particular procedure. When you enter the university, there is a particular procedure to enter, and then the process of your education begins. Now you are part of this university. You are not wavered thinking of going to this university or that university. But you are registered into one university. It is like registration into the mystery school of this particular master. Now the proper training will begin. So when you become a part, you may have visited the university many a times, but your process of inward, the education has not begun. Then when you are registered, you are the registered students of the university or the class, then your actual training begins. So initiation is that process. Initiation is that process when the student enters the mystery school of the master and the proper way of training begins. On this initiation, a chapter is given in meditation, the way to self-realization, and on bayat, this is known as, bayat is the word B-A-Y-A-T. Bayat is the word used, the Urdu word used for initiation, which is an English process. In the Old Testament, Moses used to initiate the people by giving them a bath in the holy Jordan River. And then one day all of a sudden, a man comes and stands up in front of him to be initiated. Moses is stuck dumb, seeing the person. It was Jesus who came. So Moses used to initiate the people by giving them the bath in the holy Jordan River. And he said, he who comes after me will be mightier than I, and he will initiate with fire. These are the two ways of initiating, initiation through water or initiation through fire. Sometimes later on, when I get a chance, I will speak on the process of initiation. So that day Sufi Omkarnath was initiated and thus began the edificated training of the one who is to become the light, light divine in times to come. 6 years after, in 1955, 6 years after the marriage of his daughter in 1949, 6 years later in 1955, 17th of January, Sufi Brij Mohan Lal on his way reached to the city of Mumbai in India. And that very evening, in the congregation of his devotees, his followers, his friends, his lovers, entered into Mahasamadhi. 10 days after the cremation, the body was brought on 20th of January in the same year, 1955, in the city of Lucknow. The body was brought and the cremation took place on 20th of January, and 10 days after, when Hindus celebrate according to the Hindu rites, the 10th day after the cremation of the individual, after the death of the individual, after the passing away of the person, that is known as the 10th day ceremony. That particular day, at a tender age, 1934, Omkarnath was born, and 1955, the status of the masterhood was bestowed on him. On that particular day, amidst a large congregation, the ceremony, which is known as tying of the turban on the head of the master, is the indication that from now onwards you are taking the responsibility of your father. And in the Sufi tradition, in the tradition of the masters, under the spiritual tradition, it is known as induction or anointing of the master by tying a turban on his head, and everybody acknowledges him as the next master in place of the master who has departed. The life continued like this from 1955 under the benign care of his mother, who nourished and nurtured every single flower of the garden of her husband, Sufi Brij Mohan Lal. 31st of March, 1974, Sufi Shakuntala Devi was called to visit a devotee whose daughter-in-law was in labor, and the doctor said she may not survive. If there was complications in that, she went to the city, another city, which was overnight journey from the city of Kanpur where she was staying. She goes there along with her second son of Devendranath, and on her way she returns via Lucknow, where the shrine complex of her husband is, and where now the shrine of Sufi Omkarnath is also. There, she comes to the shrine of her husband, the master, Sufi Brij Mohan Lal, and says, "Now that my work is over, take me with you." This is the quality of the master. My work is over and it is time to leave the world. I am not here for anything else. Just as when sometimes you go to a particular function, you have given a job and you tell the people that now my job is over, I have finished my work, I am ready to leave. Such was the situation. Thereafter the work continues. In 1968, when I was still there, staying in the company of these masters, Sufi Omkarnath began the talks on the masters. Talks on the masters from the golden chain of the Naqshbandi order, starting from the Holy Prophet to the current masters. So it used to happen, the talk will take place. It was not a very frequent talk or every week or so. It was intermittent talks. A talk will take place today, then maybe 1 month after, 2 months after, another talk will take place. And sometimes it used to happen that the talk is taking place during the month of winter. Winter in India is, the temperature wise is not cold, but because of the facilities, one feels more cold than anything else. The room in the city of Kanpur where Omkarnath was staying, where the Sufi was staying, it has 3 doors. 2 doors leading outside in the compound, and 1 door was leading to another room inside the house, and it was from that door the master will enter. We have a thin carpet and a white sheet is spread over it, and the room had 2 windows on one side. So 2 doors and 2 windows, because of the entry of the people coming in, the doors were always kept open. In winter, breeze is blowing, the floor is cold, the inside the room is closed, the master is sitting, and there is the congregation of the devotees, the followers, and the talk on the master will begin. So usually this talk used to begin on Saturday night around 9 o'clock or 9:30, when everybody will gather and will continue until the late in the early hours. And we are just putting on the bare clothes, sitting on the ground with no proper winter clothes, just a shawl or a thin piece of blanket covering us, and we never felt cold in that environment, although breeze is blowing. This is the status of tawajjuh of the master. The energy field, when it is the month of winter, the master, it is known as the Sufi terminology, the tawajjuh or the energy field flows from the plane of the sun. So along with the energy field, the warmth comes in, the warmth which is required for the physical body. And during the months of summer, it is, the energy is, coolness is created in the tawajjuh. This was the energy field of the master. So that you are not being put to a discomfort. And this continued talks. These were recorded as notes. The people who were conversant with the Hindi language, because the talks was mixed Hindi and then the Urdu terminology, it was recorded, penned down by the people in Hindi language. And one of our friend, he was from an Islamic community, And you can write in Urdu faster, in the Urdu language, which is the language developed in India with the mixture of the Persian and Hindi, which is known as Urdu language. And everything was, he used to write it down. This is almost like a shorthand. And the notes was taken down. Then it used to happen a few days after that, he and I will sit down together and he will translate it for me in Hindi so that I will write it down in Hindi. The collection of those talks became the forerunner for the volumes, Leaves from the Sufi Heart, Volume 1 and Volume 2. And then still the Volume 3 is to finish, wherein the life from Hazrat Mazhar Mir Jane Dana Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu, this particular master's shrine, Prem Sutra visited with me when she went to India. Hazrat Mazhar Mir Jane Dana, Hazrat Baqiullah Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu, last went to visit the shrine, the first Naqshbandi master who came. Then the second shrine, which was in the cemetery, where also Prem Sutra went with me. And in an open courtyard, the shrine was there. Hazrat Noor Muhammad Badayuni, and then his disciple Hazrat Mazhar Mir Jane Dana, whose shrine is at Turkman Gate, in New Delhi. And those Randi Dhyan Yatri who did not have the occasion to visit, you can do not feel despair or despondent. The videos of those shrines are available, and when you sit down in meditation, you will feel the same energy field as if you had been available on those shrines. Physically, such is the energy field of the masters. The life of Sufi Omkar Nath continued, nourishing and nurturing everyone that came in his company. In January of 2008, after 19 years I visited India, and that particular day morning, the night before I reached the city of Lucknow, when the evening Thursday prayer was going on, and then the Friday morning I visited upstairs the Sufi Omkar Nath, there was pensive mood, very indrawn, as if he is withdrawing himself from the life. Usually, when I am in his company, the talks becomes fewer. Never talks, only silence. So he asked me how long I am here. I told him that after visiting you, I'll be going to the other shrines, and then a few days after I'll be going back to Trinidad. There was silence. In that silence, it was felt that this is our last meeting. Then on 20th of January, on the full moon day when Buddha entered Mahaparinirvan, Sufi Omkar Nath entered into Samadhi. We pay our homage to this master, that this nisbat, this inner connection may continue as long and our lives be a flower that can be offered at the altar of the divine. Decorating our life like a flower, I shall continue, erelong. Embellishing life to be a flower for thy altar, I shall erelong sing thy glories. Embellishing life to be a flower for thy altar, I shall erelong sing thy glory. Jeevan suman chadhakar, तेरी जन्म जन्म तेरी हम अर्चना करेंगे. आई विल वर्शिप यू बाय ऑफरिंग अवर लाइफ एज अ फ्लावर एट थाई ऑल्टर. जन्म जन्म हम तेरी वंदना करेंगे. लाइफ लॉन्ग एंड लॉन्ग आई कंटिन्यू टू सिंग थाई ग्लोरीज. जीवन सुमन चढ़ाकर तेरी हम अर्चना करेंगे. जन्म जन्म तेरी वंदना करेंगे. बाहुनी जीवन पुष्प तप चढ़े कीर्ति गाऊं तुझे जन्मो जन्म. बाहुनी जीवन पुष्प तप चरणी कीर्ति गाऊं तुझे जन्मो जन्म. मे द सिस्टम ऑफ स्पिरिचुअल डेवलपमेंट, may this system of spiritual transference continue and on. Ya ilahi taabat kayam rahe ye silsila. May this system of spirituality continue and on. Ek lamha jo guzra hai tere saath, एक लम्हा जो गुजरा है तेरे साथ, छा जाए जिंदगी में मेरी बन के नूर. गुजरे है लम्हे जिंदगी के, गुजरे है लम्हे जिंदगी के, तेरी सोहबत में जो बन गए हैं वो आज लम्हे नूर जिंदगी के मेरी बन गए हैं वो आज लम्हे नूर जिंदगी के मेरी बन के निस्बते नक्शबंदी बन के निस्बते नक्शबंदी छाए है जिंदगी में मेरी फूलों को है रंजिश फूलों को है रंजिश महकाते हैं आशियाने को जादू फूलों को है रंजिश महकाते हैं आशियाने को जब गुजर रही है जिंदगी उन्हीं लम्हों के सदके में अब गुजर रही है जिंदगी उन्हीं लम्हों के सदके में अब यूं ही गुजरती जाए जिंदगी दुआ है बस यही रब से दुआ है बस यही रब से. ओनली दिस मच फॉर दिस मॉर्निंग एज ए ट्रिब्यूट टू नक्शबंदी सूफी ओंकारनाथ. इन द मेडिटेशन टाइम्स ऑफ दिस मंथ अ ट्रिब्यूट इज गिवन. You can go through that particular document. This morning's talk was slightly different from what was written so that you become aware of many dimensions of the Master. Only this much for this morning. Take care and do have a blessed night.